for our alumni. Welcome to this festive evening, where we have a the premiere of the FryslânDOK Yes, We Can, created by Omrop Fryslân. And also welcome during this first UCF LUSTRUM event. So it's the first LUSTRUM event for the University College Fryslân. My name is Roel Spinder. For the people who don't know me, I will try to guide you to this evening with the help of many others, which I'm very thankful for. Again, welcome. The program of this day, we start with a word of welcome from our program director, Dr. Indira van der Sande. I have to stand still, I think. Or this microphone is also on. I don't know. I will walk around. So we start with the word of welcome. Then we have a short panel discussion. And then the documentary maker, Annet Huisman, who is also here, will give you a short introduction on the documentary. And then we're going to see a part of the documentary, part three of the documentary, Yes, We Can. And afterwards, we have a Q&A session with the students who are all online. Ben, do you know what it is? Ah, that's this one. Setting which a lot of alumni and also students are familiar with. Then we switch to a Q&A session with Lea, Lina, Linnea, Susanna, and Annette. Annette will be here in person, is sitting here in the front row in red. But first, I would like to give an applause to Indira van der Sande, and invite her to the stage.
Thanks, Rowan. Well, a word of welcome sounds very big. It's really a word of welcome. Hi. On behalf of everyone, the entire college board, Dean Andrit Switter, Piet Bauma, and everyone here at the faculty, I also have the issue of where to stand so that I also address the students who are sitting mostly over there, which is very exciting, next to our other group. Yeah, 5 years. Wow, 5 years ago, the UCF University College Fryslân started and opened the doors. And now we're here. For those of you who were there, I'm not sure if you remember that Marisa was there for sure. She's over there. A lot of our staff. We started in a different building. I don't know if you remember. We were in the Z building. We had two classrooms and two offices in that building with our university college. And small scale and personalized was never more personalized. I think we had groups of 12 students, right? And academic advisement groups of four, maybe. Berfu Una was teaching the entire psychology major and academic communication, so you saw her nonstop. And a lot of our staff who's here today developed entire tracks, whereas we are now sharing them with 5 to 10 others. So how much we've grown, how excited it was when we moved here to the Burs. We had our big opening. We were finally a faculty with a university building and many more classrooms. And how sad when we had to leave, right? When COVID hit after half a year already in a college which was just in the startup phase. So also, I still, when I think about it, because sometimes we are so used to living with COVID now that it's normal, but when I think about it, how we switched overnight, I remember on Thursday, we sent an email saying, we're going to lockdown, we go online, and on Monday, classes are online. Staff and students, amazing, amazing adaptability to what we were able to do. And like Roel Niel said, we're very used to it now, right? Hybrid settings, still not our favorite. We do try, because the University College is so focused on personal and small scale education, we really try to be on site, we really try to set up this community. And I think we are relatively successful, I would say. We're quite happy with where we are. Best program of the Netherlands, obviously. But I think, just as a side note, you can never mention it. Sometimes you just need to mention it, right? Just very putting it out there. But besides that, I think what everyone, when you talk to our community, what everyone says, what makes the program so special, yes, it's the content. It's the fact that everyone wants to contribute to making a better world, to doing this through science, finding solutions, but also the community. I think this is one of the biggest issues, it's the biggest amazing things. One of the biggest things that people always refer to is the fact that we were able to set up this community, which includes everyone, which includes our staff members, which includes our students, our alumni now, two cohorts of alumni already. I'm so happy that some of you are here, finally picking up your degree, I think. Yes, also good. So this is something I think, yes, let's make sure that we also stay committed to having this community together and making, we have the University College Fryslân, which offers a program, which we offer a global responsibility and leadership program, which is your study, but we offer so much more. We offer the entire adventure, the entire journey, the entire community. And this is what we all share and are committed to. And I'm super excited about tonight. I know Annet did an amazing job with the documentary. I saw some previews already. I think it really shows also. To me, it was so amazing to see this journey, but I'll tell you more about it, of the young people, the young generation, where you are and what your ambitions are and your dreams. And yeah, I hope we can contribute to that in one way or another. So again, welcome, thank you, and on to the next 5 years.
Thank you so much, India, for the very nice words. You can stay on stage because we're going to go to the next part of the program, which is the panel discussion. So Indira, please come sit on a table. Marise, Esme, and also André, can you please come forward? We're going to have a short panel discussion based on five statements. I will give someone the floor and who can react to it, and then you can react toward each other. I will stand there, otherwise it's very awkward. And if you don't remember the statements, they're on the screen here, or on the big screen in the back. Let's start with the first one. The fact that UCF with the GRL program has a big percentage of international students, this has added value for the community and the program itself. And I would like to ask Marise first, as an alumna of the program, to reflect on it. You had 2 years to think about it, so please. Yes, you should put on the microphone, otherwise online people can't hear
you. Hear me, okay. So I had some time to reflect on it. And I think it brought us together in Kanaalstraat a lot while cooking, actually. We like to taste everyone's like desserts and dishes and everything. I think we also did like a potluck dinner that everyone brought some of their food. So we really actually connected through the international food, I think. But we also had, I think, only one person outside of Europe by then. So it was a lot inside of Europe people. So I think, yeah, it would be nice to have from all over the world, of course, but it was the beginning, so can't blame on that. But I think that would even be nicer. But yeah, it was very nice to have a lot of internationals in there.
Thank you, Maurice. And how is it now, Esme?
I would say similarly, it is for me personally, it is quite a benefit to have a lot of people from different countries. I think especially in the way that also just people from different cultures often communicate differently. And so not even necessarily that content is different, although of course it will be, but just the way you discuss things. And I think it leads to new discussions just because, you know, maybe people's willingness to be more direct or less direct, or I think even those like subtleties are quite enriching. And then I think similarly it would still be lovely to have more countries represented, more backgrounds, but it is definitely, I think, enriching in the classroom and as part of the community, like you said, in more informal settings. Yeah.
Thank you, Esme. Indira, have you something to add on this?
well, nothing to add to these words. I think very, very good to hear from you in the community how it is. But I think when we also set up the college and developed it, we always said ideally we have some kind of UN of students, right? It's we have students from every country, and everyone learns and shares and goes back, and then also translates the knowledge back. So that is an ambition we've always had, which we're not there yet. It is better than when you when you were starting. I mean, this is also why we have the UCF Foundation, for example, really trying to also provide scholarship for the students who have less means to come here. So this is definitely, I think, I agree with you. Even within a group that is relatively homogeneous, you can still learn so much. Just, it's not even culture only, right? It's also your upbringing, where you're coming, well, that is all culture, by the way. But there's much more to the country than just being from a different country. But yeah, the ambition is there to make it even more diverse. Yeah.
Thank you. Andre, you will be on the next, or would you like to react to this?
Okay.
We have five statements, so.
Yeah, that's all right. That's all right. I've got time, you know. Everybody wants to see the documentary, including me, so I know. But no, I think, as you said, the UN of programs, that's what we said in the beginning, 192 students every year. Well, we still have to work towards that, and we are. But you know, international cohort, international in the international component is a source of diversity. And I think that is really what we are after, creating a diversity of experience and thereby also a diversity of opinion. And bringing people together from different backgrounds and allowing them to give different views, that used to be really our slogan, a different view. Giving different views and different voices on the same topic to the people and to the students and the staff members in our cohort. This is really what we are after, and we still strive for that. And I think that is so important that we keep working on that, because diversity is what makes us richer.
Which is a very nice bridge to the following, or to the second statement. The second statement is, the sometimes prevailing green norm can be a barrier for incoming students and staff. Indira, can you reflect on it first?
Can you reflect on how you created this green norm? No, I think it's a very interesting statement, and it's a discussion we keep having, I think, from year one till where we are right now. It keeps coming back. You will also see it in the documentary. I think the type of program that we are, we attract people that want to make a difference, so they also have strong opinions on how the world should be. And we have a relatively normative program, right? We also have set out, we want to make contribution to the SDGs. So that's kind of inherent in the program, but at the same time, we're really trying to be big proponents of pluralism, as Elise would always say in the classes as well. It is about being tolerant, but it's even like more. It's about also being open to different views, like you already mentioned, and stepping out of your echo chamber. And I think if you look at the world right now, it's crazy. We all know that. And a bit more openness or awareness of where others are coming from might come a long way. So I think it is something we really appreciate in the students and in the staff, by the way, that we have strong beliefs and values and that we are committed and go for it. But at the same time, we would like to have an even more pluralistic view where we also welcome diverse opinions and maybe talk to each other. Why is this so important for you? And do you also realize, if I'm coming from a region that is struggling with very different elements, maybe this is more important to me at this point? And discuss the trade-offs and decisions involved. Yeah.
Thank you, Indira. And Esme, how is that? Do you see a shift towards more pluralism after you follow the classes of Elise?
Yes, those beautiful lectures on listening, they're very helpful. Yeah, I think the question of whether it's sort of a deterrent almost to enter, because it's this green norm sometimes creates sort of this exclusivity, I think it's quite an interesting concept. And the norm in itself does not have to be inherently exclusive. And I think that's something really in our program that we're striving for as we talk about the qualities like listening, is how to shift the narrative of this green norm to being something that kind of emerges from pride and encouragement, instead of that the idea is that this norm is confined by, you know, shaming others to fit within these certain boxes. And I think this shift to saying, you know, these are some values that a lot of these students are expressing, and therefore, you know, we are going to support each other in in living these values in the way we want, but I think with that sort of pride and that that stance of real like support, I think then is what is going to allow also different opinions to emerge, because then it's not just this exclusive bubble that's provided by, you know, shame and other things. Yeah, which can happen.
Which can happen, mm-hmm. Yes. And how was it back in the days, Marise?
Well, back in the days. Yeah, the green norm, I think, was always there. And I absolutely wasn't the greenest when I joined. So I can also say that throughout the courses, I also got a bit more motivated, but also learned some tips and tricks from people. And my mom still won't believe me, but my showers are a lot shorter than when I joined the bachelor. So it actually has motivated me as well to change some things, but as long as it doesn't get like suppressed on you. And I don't think that is the case. But it can be like feel that way when you join, that people look at you that you have a plastic container instead of glass. Oh no. And then you think by yourself, like, oh, should I change it? But through the classes, you get to know yourself a bit more maybe as well, and then you change it by yourself. So I think that's the whole story.
Thank you. And how's that for staff, Andre? Can you?
Well, as a staff community, we always said that Campus Fryslân is a community of care. We care for each other, we care as much as we care for our students. And care needs to consider the different conditions that people are under. And when you look at the green norm that cares very much for the environment, sometimes people just don't have the luxury to give that care at that moment, because the livelihood depends on a different kind of action. And so care means also understanding that certain people would love maybe to change, but they see the livelihood threatened. And so it means that we need to find ways of conversing with each other that takes the others as agents of their own making serious, and opens up the way for letting people out of, you know, one-way streets. And just by saying you're doing it wrong, I remember there was a song in Germany, and those of you who followed the German news at that time might know, but I translated, and the song was sung by kindergarten children, and it literally said, my grandma is an environmental pig. And that put such a shock in the German community, because it showed, although well meant, a lack of understanding that there was not such a norm at that time. People did not know. And I think that is really important, to put ourselves in other people's shoes.
To stay in contact, to keep communicating.
Keep talking,
yes. Thank you. We go on because we don't have a lot of time, and it would be a short panel discussion, so we go to the third statement, which is quite an obvious one, I must say, but events with worldwide impact like the war in Ukraine, the COVID pandemic, those big events have a big influence on students and their well-being. And as May, I think you're the student assessor of Campus Fryslân, so can you please react on this statement?
Yeah, I think absolutely. Just, of course, I mean, there's members of our community that are directly, really have a close tie to these events. And I think all of the people that are entering this community have entered it because they are really actively empathetic people and have care for the world and want to instill change. And so, of course, that these big events have a huge impact, both emotionally, just how people are practically going about their lives. And I think it's quite natural that they would. And then I think also, you know, crisis is like climate change and everything that we're also very aware that spark more existential angst. I think it's been quite a journey within our community also to figure out how to support one another with those sorts of, those mental implications of, you know, this fear of the future and all of that. And so I think having this community of people that are also experiencing similar things and figuring out how, you know, more solutions-oriented courses and other things can help really help shift that doom and gloom narrative and spark change, I think is quite valuable. But of course, yeah, these are very felt crises.
And in Indira, how do we as a community, as UCF staff, deal with these anxious feelings of students? And when such events happens, like COVID, but also the war in Ukraine, the climate crisis, of course.
Yeah, I mean, it's like Espen already said, some of the things are there from the start, right? Because we're already, when you know, you get into the program, there's already issues in the world. That's why you're concerned, and that's why you're doing a program like this. So I think it's already a group also of staff and also of students who are very aware already. And I think André also discussed it in one of his lectures at some point, like the weight of the world on your shoulders, how big that is, and trying to figure out how can you make that small change and ignite a small fire also with little steps. But yeah, coming to your question, I'm sorry. How do we as staff deal with that? It's really difficult. Well, we try, but of course everyone is so, everyone needs their own response almost, because like you said, some people are personally affected, the same for staff, right? We have staff members from the different countries affected at the moment. There is the whole situation in Iran at the moment, which is affecting also a lot of our members next to the bigger ones. So we try, I think, also a lot through our study advisor, Micah, who is also here, to stay in contact with everyone. I think that's the one thing. Also, in the first COVID pandemic, I think that was kind of the people left. And we were kind of like, oh my, like, how do we maintain this community when everyone goes back home? And so we really learned also, yeah, different tips and tricks and kind of like still being a group and still staying connected, even though these events happen, and finding a common ground. And also finding, I think, outlets. I mean, there was this beautifully organized activism for Ukraine event, so also finding outlets to deal with the challenges that we have. But again, here, it's also, we are also always wondering ourselves, because there are events happening all the time, and we also wonder, well, in the College Board, for example, like, how do we respond to this? What can we do? How do we reach out? So again, if you have ideas, you're always very welcome.
Thank you. Marise, André, do you would like to react to this, or is this, I think it's quite obvious, right? And then, yeah. Let's go on with the fourth statement. The UCF program needs more male students, needs more men in the program to give a more realistic reflection of society, which will increase the quality of discussions in the classrooms. We
and
people are some male alumni here, so I'm very happy that they're here. But yeah, in this documentary, the Annet is following four female students who are living together, and yeah, we all know that we have a lot of female students in class. Yeah, first reaction to this. I know the first cohort was also more female than male, right, Marise?
Yeah, the guys were quite lonely, I think. Now, in our cohort, I'm not talking for you. I think in our cohort, we maybe had four or five guys. But I find it hard in this statement to find a side, because I think people should be in the courses and in our education because they want to be and because they like it. And it's the same actually as I think of jobs. Like, you should hire someone that's best at the job and not look at the gender. So if it's then accidentally females who come to study more, then so be it. A bit like, yeah. Maybe for a reflection in society, for in class, it would be nice to have some more males to see the other side when talking about, yeah, stuff about periods and pregnancies. We talk about that like in classes a lot, but I remember, and easily as well, because you have a lot of women. Maybe there are also topics that guys would like to talk about more, but aren't comfortable with. So that's a bit hard to say.
Thank you, André.
I think periods and pregnancies, indeed, a topic that guys should also be talking about. And I can tell you, they might be uncomfortable with that, as you said. But no, I disagree with this statement. I disagree because I think quality of discussion is not directly related. Maybe to diversity, and I think that's where the statement really comes from, right? So, and in that sense, I agree. I think diversity will enrich it, and as Marise said, important is that we have the right people for this program who really care, and that there is a tendency in the gender balance that slightly tips when it comes to topics such as these, sustainability and care for the environment. That is known to us. I think what we can do, and I think that is what we should do, is to see how we can connect this to topics that are also relevant in other discourses and in other groups, so that we see that we reach out. And if anything, let's make use of that power that we have, and see that we build with our student cohort to reach out to all kinds of communities. And now we are working on reaching out to Leeuwarden Oost. So maybe that is also a good way of translating that care.
Yeah, I think for the most part, I don't know if even diversity is necessarily confined or correlated with gender, but I do definitely see there is a discrepancy between in representation of genders with our program for sure. And I, I don't know. I'd hope maybe sustainability somehow is still somehow linked to female or some sort of prejudice there. And I would hope that at a certain point that is no longer serving. And I think the openness of our program hopefully is helping to diminish that certain prejudice or those value confines.
Thank you. Yeah, it's working again, Ben. Thank you. Anything to add on, Indira, or is it?
No, I think I agree with most of what you've said. It's a common thing among university colleges in general. So I think it's also a bigger trend. We see that. If you look at gender only, people identifying as male tend to go for more monodisciplinary disciplines, whereas women tend to go for more multidisciplinary disciplines. At the same time, if we look at the state of the world, I think we can use some female leadership, and if this is how we get there, let's go.
I totally agree with you. Then we go to the final statement of this short panel discussion. There it is. The UCF community is the best part of the program as a student, as staff, and also as an alumnus. Esme, first reaction?
I agree. I think it is a really amazing community, and it really is fostered by the fact that we get the chance to live together, we're studying together. You know, there's a lot of collaboration between people in many different environments, which I think always helps establish like a basis of trust. And then when you have that trust, that's so optimal to learning, because then people are able to share, and we're very fortunate. We have incredible lecturers and other people that really, I think, help guide education in a way that can be challenging and also allow people to really confront things that they might not have previously. And then fortunately they're in that community that is supportive and is, I hope, enabling a lot of growth.
Thank you. Andre, was this also the idea of course it's part of being a university college, but invest so much and see the community growing, is this what you were aiming for when you?
Absolutely. That was and is and will ever remain, I think, the building block that makes us as a community special. And as a faculty board, we have this privilege of every year having one of the a sneak preview, so to speak, from that community. Now with you, Esme, with Max. Where is he? There he is. Very good. And before with Hannah and with Esther Alder. So it's nice to kind of get through their eyes also always a view into that community and how strong it is. And I think, if anything, then let's make this community even stronger, because that is the community that you'll have for the rest of your life.
Thank you. And how was it for you, Marisa? You were the first cohort, so you were starting, and every year there was a new group coming in that community, and the staff was growing and growing.
True. I know we got very attached to our first academic advisors as well, first year, because we were so small and the first building was also small. Everything was small. But it was also nice to see the new students coming in, seeing grow bigger. But unfortunately, we also missed a lot, of course, because of COVID. But we had the luck to be in a half year still in Kanaalstraat when it happened. So the first half year, we still had each other there. So that was very nice. But we missed a small year maybe, but it's nice to see that when you come back. So I went back to the gala as well. I thought no one would remember me, but everyone did. So that was nice, so that you can always come back. So that's really good to see that it's still alive after you go and go graduate.
Thank you, Marisa. You already started, Indira, with your word of welcome on this statement. So I think everyone is, and we're on time, which is also quite good. Let's go to the thing where we're all here for. I would like to thank Indira, Marise, Esme, and Andre, and let's go on to the final part. Back to the PowerPoint band, we have a short introduction, of course, by Annet, before we go there.
Hi, so nice to have everybody here, so many more people than I had expected, because everybody busy, and films you can see on television, you can see them online, no need to go to the bus at the evening when you want other things to do. So really nice that everybody is here, and for me it's always so excited to show something to the audience, because you know people are watching it online and at home, and it's completely different than when you sit together and you watch something together, and I'm really excited to do that. We did a session with the four main characters of the film, of course. Let me say it right, Leia, Lina, Linnea, Marianna, and Susanna. We did it last week, and I saw their little faces on my phone watching it, and they were also, it was really spannend. What is the word? Fearful. Of course, it was a bit fearful for them to see what, because as a documentary maker, you have so much power, you know. It is really crazy how much power you have by filming, by choosing, by editing, by putting music, by cutting out people and putting people in. And I always get nervous sometimes with when you feel that the power that is in your hands and the responsibility you have for your main characters to have them really shine through and be sincere with them and do them right. And sometimes it can be a bit dodgy, because you want to do right, but also you want to tell a story. So sometimes you want to make something stronger, right? Or sometimes you think maybe that is a little bit painful, but maybe it's okay that it's painful. But you think, what would the person feel about being vulnerable in my film, right? So it's so always so many things that you have in your hands to decide to. And of course, I'm not alone. I work with the staff. I have the wonderful cameraman. He's there. Gerko, can you stand up? And Jan, can you stand up? And there is also my wonderful editor, Larissa Lokenberg. There is my boss, Peter Tjertsma, who allowed me to do that. Thank you. Thank you for the applause. And there is Wietse. He knows everything about filming with a phone. Right. Okay. And the question I get the most from the people as a documentary maker is, how do you come up with your subjects? People always want to know, but how do you come up with your subject? Well, this time, faith put me right in the middle between, I am living really in the middle of Kanaalstraat and the courthouse. How was that possible, right? And I didn't know this. I was living in between the Kanaalstraat and the courthouse, and I had no idea. Till one wintry night, you will see it in the film, I got a little note. I found it through my letterbox on the floor, and I picked it up, and it was in really little fine writing. It was in English. It was a very old-fashioned letter in an envelope written by Susanna Stawiska. You know her, she's from Poland. She's this wonderful, wonderful student of yours.
she had seen something on my door, and you will see it in the film, that had caught her eye. And this young woman was so brave that she first had knocked my door because she didn't know how the bell was working. It's an old-fashioned Dutch thing, and you have to really have to pull it. And there was nobody at home. And what she did, you are in this new digital age, right? Everything online, WhatsApp. But she wrote an old-fashioned letter to me, and that was so great. So I read it and said, oh, this is so nice. I have to write a letter back. So I went to Kanaalstraat and I put it in the box. And then she came over to me to have tea, and then you'll see everything started, because I had never heard about global responsibility. So how many times have I said this? This is so funny, global responsibility and leadership. What is it? And also my friends from everywhere in the Netherlands, they say, what is this kind of funny study? I've never heard of it, right? So I thought, this must be a story. And Susanna, of course, she was living somewhere else. I had four students next to me. And then came the next year, and then came the new group of women next to me. And I thought, I want to make a story about that. And so I went there, I had dinner with them. And of course, you have to see, is there a story in it? And I was having dinner with four young women who were so smart. You know, we were talking, and I thought, you know, I have a past living in groups. I am from the, what you say, the squatting time, if you say it, kraken, right? So I was always living with groups together, sitting together, cooking together, talking together, politics together, doing actions together. But I can tell you, we talked a lot of bullshit there. We were not so smart. So I was sitting there, and then I thought, wow, these women talk really good stuff here. And this is what I see with you all. I am so full of admiration of what you do here. The things you work on, the level of education and the level of sincereness, I recognize really what you say about the community. Everybody is so sincere with each other. And that really touched me. And I thought, yes, this is a story I want to tell an audience. And I remember Lina said after some weeks, she said, but Annet, do you really think this is interesting for people? Our lives, is it interesting? And as a maker, you're never 100% sure, you know? Because until then you make it, then you know, it's okay. But I said, yes, you have no idea how interesting your life is. So, having said that, it was so nice, of course, that they said yes, because I had to ask their permission. And that is quite a thing, that because I also am the neighbor. So there's always somewhere next to your house who is sort of watching you, right? It can be really creepy. So they know I'm very thankful that they gave me this permission to do that. And that is really great of these five women, because it's quite something. Really, it's not nothing that someone asked, can I go there? Can I film you? Can I be there? So a big thanks to them. And also, of course, a big thanks for the staff of Campus Fryslân, because for them, you know, it is also a bit, for you, it's a bit fearful. As you told me, we have no idea what it's going to be, right? So I really admire that, and I'm very thankful too that you gave me permission to do that. And that also portrays you, I think, as Campus Fryslân, that you say, okay, we don't know, but well, we hope it will be good. And thank you for giving me the trust to do that, and that's really great. And also have to thank all the other students who I annoyed sometimes with camera being there. I know there were sometimes some comments on, oh, this is woman again, can she go, please? And I can understand that, really, because you also, yeah, it can be intimidating having a camera there. But I know as a maker that sometimes you just have to, you know, you just have to be there. You have to put the camera there because you want to know how this guy is looking, you know? And I also have to make some excuses for the people who I cut out. I see here Joris over there. Yes. Because no, it's just the thing, I am a storyteller, right? And I have these four women there who I have to follow. And then you are there.
I'm happy you did it.
That's a really nice thing to say, but I know how it feels because you are there in the film, you will see. I did say some smart things. Why not? You know? But this is the art of making a film. You have to choose. And my editor over there is very strict. She said, no, 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 it's about these five women, not about the others. And she's right. Okay? Okay. This is not the Oscars. Enough talking. Okay, let's move. I will tell you what you will see when Indira and Roman and Angeline came to watch. They choose for the third part because that is the last part, and that is the living labs, and that is really nice to see how it works. But what we added is the introduction of part one, because then you can see how it all started, and the rest you can see later on. Enjoy.
Nazywam się Zuzanna Stawiska. To był mój pierwszy rok studiów na Campus Fryslân. Pewnego razu, parę domów od akademika, w którym mieszkałam, coś przykuło moją uwagę. Wprawdzie napis nie był po polsku, ale nazwisko autora brzmiało znajomo. Wisława Szymborska.
Also, I wanted to look at different types of flowers, so like from Iraq and Syria as well. So if we do some flower crafting tonight.
Okay.
I think that would be cool as well.
Why from there?
Hmm?
Why from there?
Because I have friends from there who are refugees and who had to flee also because of the war, so.
Mało kogo tu znałam, było zimno i dość niegościnnie, w dodatku daleko od domu.
I'm just figuring out which way to... Okay, yes, I think I'm doing it the right way.
But it's not very, I don't know how high this is supposed to be. Is it supposed to be round?
W skrócie. osoba, która umieściła drzwi i kamienia na swoich drzwiach, kręci dokumenty dla fryzyjskiej telewizji. Zaprosiła mnie na herbatę, gadałyśmy, spytała, co robię tu w Leeuwarden. Więc opowiedziałam jej o kierunku, który studiuję. Global Responsibility and Leadership.
Let me fly away with you.
Oh, damn!
For my love is like the wind.
No i się zaczęło. W przyszłym roku, co ciekawe, tuż obok wprowadziły się 4 studentki z mojego roku. To znaczy też studiujące ten dziwny kierunek o pompatycznej nazwie Global Responsibility and Leadership. To one spróbują opowiedzieć, co za nią stoi i co znaczy dla nich.
My background, like introduce myself, you mean?
In a way.
My background. So I come from Lithland. Latvia. That's where I lived all my life. Went to school. Have wonderful family with 2 annoying brothers.
I'm Portuguese, and I was born there. And I moved throughout Portugal when I was younger because of my mom's work and everything.
I'm from Germany, from Wolfsburg, and I graduated in 2017 from high school. So my mom is a teacher in a primary school, and so she always really took care of me learning things and engaging with my surroundings and things like that. And my dad is an electrician with, or was, he's actually retired now, an electrician with Bugatti.
So I'm from the south of Germany, near Stuttgart. And my family comes from like a middle class background. So my mom, for example, took over a family business, and my dad is an engineer. Sorry, dad. He's not an architect, he's an engineer.
And so I moved to the Netherlands when I was 16, and I think that was really like, I don't know, I think it was just the idea of an adventure and going out of the country and seeing different parts of the world. It was more like that.
We live in this, we call it the GRL bubble, just all the people and staff and students. It's really nice in this bubble where everyone cares about the planet and cares about each other.
My head produces a lot more questions than it produces answers.
The things I'm most passionate about is politics and economics.
Sometimes it can kind of become a competitive thing, like who's the wokest person.
The course is called Global Responsibility, but I think you can take that responsibility on words as a collective. You cannot take it in just as one single person, because you also don't have the power to.
Kojarzysz coś takiego jak SDG? Sustainable Development Goals, wytyczone przez ONZ, to 17 celi na najbliższą dekadę. Obejmują różne aspekty życia. Zdrowie, edukacja, ubóstwo, równość płci itd. Generalnie dążenie do bardziej sprawiedliwego i zrównoważonego świata dla wszystkich.
In just a bit, Augustina and Nini are coming, and they are my Living Lab project partners, or more so, my team. So they're on the Living Lab project with me, and we're working together with Bufra and Bufra, which is like a local initiative here in Leeuwarden. And we have visited the Bufra and Bufra bus and the shop before several times now over the last couple of weeks. And last week, they asked us if we want to cook something for them so they can then distribute the food to people who are currently in need of it. So that's what we're doing today.
Yeah, the box.
We set up like a, a box at uni the last couple of days where people could donate food, because we asked them for specific things like couscous and zucchini and bell pepper and so on, because our plan is to make couscous now for as many people as possible.
But to be honest, I never made couscous.
Really? Oh,
okay.
Okay. No, I have made it several times before. I'm excited. They have a lot of. I'm just trying to think when was the last time that I cooked for so many people, and I'm not sure. How are you doing there?
Good.
Yeah.
Waiting for the water to boil.
Ah!
Nice. Does someone want to taste it, by the way? I'm going to taste them now.
Yes.
I feel like maybe we should rinse them first, though.
Why? Oh my god, they have green stuff.
Yeah, I don't know if they were supposed to get green or not.
As far as I remember, no.
Oh. Mm. Okay.
Yeah.
Nini, do you want to try? Mm.
I think they're super nice if you just sprinkle them on your food, you know?
Yeah. I have to send these to Cecilia and Luis. Our living lab hosts.
Studijemy Global Responsibility and Leadership na Campus Fryslân. Nasz program przyciąga całkiem sporo studentów zagranicznych, więc środowisko jest coraz bardziej międzynarodowe. Naszym zadaniem analizować, rozgryzać współczesne problemy, takie jak ocieplenie klimatu, bieda, nierówności społeczne. To jest identyfikowane w celach zrównoważonego rozwoju ONZ. A to moje koleżanki z drugiego roku. Linnea z Niemiec, Mariana z Portugalii, Lina z Łotwy i Lea, też Niemka. Nazywam się Zuzanna Stawiska. Jestem z Krakowa, z Polski. Też studiuję GRL. Tej zimy spotkałam Annet, która kręci filmy dokumentalne i mieszka tuż obok wspomnianej czwórki. Tej wiosny nasz uniwersytet wziął udział w lokalnym projekcie BOSK. Za jego sprawą Leeuwarden zmieniło się w ruchomą dżunglę. Celem było zwrócić uwagę przechodniów na takie sprawy jak ocieplenie klimatu, zasoby naturalne czy bioróżnorodność.
Made with love. Okay, then basically we're gonna have these little SDGs around the building, like 17 spots, and there's an app, basically a Google form, which people open, and then they get like SDG 1 and a question, and then they have to go and find the exact spot of the SDG, and then they enter the answer of that question in the Google form, and at the end they get like, yay, you did well or not so well, I don't know. A, you get to know the building, especially people from the outside, and B, you learn that the world is not as bad as you think, because all of these answers are kind of better than you would think, so it's like about hope, and it's not that bad.
Hoeveel procent van al het plastic in de wereld eindigt in de oceaan? Die weet ik volgens mij.
Hoeveel denk je?
Mag ik het zien?
Minder dan 6, ongeveer 36 of meer dan 66?
Ik denk meer dan 66.
Ja, ik ook.
Zoveel?
Zoveel?
Ja, oh, wat vreselijk.
Want volgens mij wel.
Waar is de ocean?
Yeah. Okay, so basically the idea is that we're gonna have a screen on the wall, and then people can lay down here, and basically it feels like they're laying under the trees, looking up in the trees, or the leaves going like this. And we're gonna have relaxing music in the background.
I personally struggled with anxiety and depression not so much anymore, and at some point I just asked myself, why am I not happy? And about 2 years ago, maybe, that changed. And I also noticed, like only very recently, that I'm actually smart.
How did you miss this?
And then again, it's the gendered aspect that to it, because I was always someone who thought differently. I was always someone who either got a different solution or got it more quick.
In school, I often felt belittled because I felt like we should take a different route or there's a different answer to it. And in my head, it got ingrained to first think about what everybody else is thinking and whether my answer is wrong instead of thinking why my answer is right. That happens in my experience, especially to smart girls, because, well, people don't take them seriously and they often fall in line more than boys. When they're really smart, they act out because they're taught that that's okay. And girls, they're taught to be social and agreeable. I am working with the province, Fryslân, on how to implement broad prosperity. Broad prosperity, brede welvaart, is a Dutch concept that basically says we don't want to look at only money anymore when we make decisions.
Well, our overarching theme for a province at the moment is happiness on one, so it mainly is on the more individual side of it. So currently that would be the effective narrative, but I agree with you, this is also of course always open for discussion and debate. What's the next narrative for the coming coming years to come?
Sustainability discussion are of course the SDGs, and they really were able to mobilize a lot of countries and a lot of regions to work together and also work with different departments or like cross-sectorally basically. And this is, I think, also something to consider here, to think broader than just one region. And for example, I personally think it's very worth considering doing it with the northern provinces, for example. But of course, in the end, we're doing it for the youth, for the people who are, for the generations to come. So that's also something to always consider, I think.
Well, I'm really happy with the result. Good luck tomorrow, of course, also with the formal presentation. But I think if it goes like this, you're completely on the right spot. So thank you.
Yeah. Can I say? I want to say something because, yeah. Like for me, the most difficult thing to change is fear, because the way we're living right now is something we're used to, and we don't know where we're going, but we know we need to change. And I think there is a lot of fear behind it, either from will we make it, will we save the world, will we be able to live in it, or will I be able to live the way I've always lived, especially for maybe older generations, for my grandparents. Well, I've lived like this certain way my whole life, and the fear of letting this go and of falling is something, yeah, that's really terrifying, I think, for a lot of people. But we need to realize that there is not only the possibility of falling, but also the possibility of succeeding, of flying in the end, kind of. And I think that's really, really important when we talk about sustainability and really widespread societal change, that there is the possibility for success and for a really beautiful future, actually. But that's really difficult to realize. Oh my god.
Nice. There. That's me.
Nice. Good job.
Thank you. Yeah. We'll see. It says, we pakken in Leeuwarden Courant Award. I don't exactly know how that translates to in English, but it has the picture, like the wheelbarrow there from the market where they get food. It has the title, Studenten zelf als buurvrouw aan de slag.
Vandaag is dan eindelijk het officiële moment dat wij ons rapport mogen overhandigen aan jullie allemaal. Oh. Aan Esmeralda, onze partner van de Living Lab, de buurvrouw en buurvrouw winkel, maar ook aan jullie. Want jullie hebben ook elke keer ons zoveel energie gegeven om hier te komen. En zoveel...
Ja, dat is leuk, of niet?
Dat is echt heel leuk. En daar willen we jullie dan ook heel erg voor bedanken.
Ah, dankjewel.
Ja, echt heel erg bedankt. En ook Pauline, onze supervisor. Our supervisor, we thank you very much for all the great help. And all the support. And every time we looked into a report, there's such good feedback. We're very thankful for that.
Dankjewel.
Ik ben heel erg blij mee, ook omdat jullie heel goede tips hebben gegeven. Waarbij we al meteen zeiden van, daar kunnen we wat mee. Hè? Daar gaan we iets mee doen. Dus het wordt zeker... opgevolgd. En dat het zo goed onderbouwd is, dat is echt geweldig.
Yeah. I'll have to use a sock again. So what I'm doing right now is the main activity of the pocket garden program. Like, I guess you can tell why it's called pocket garden, because you know, it's a tiny garden. And this educational program is the program that me and Lotte and Julia, who are my Living Lab teammates, were asked to make an assessment of. So basically, this is a program with first and second grade children, and it runs for about 2 weeks, just to get them curious about where does food come from? What is food, in a sense, you know? Getting them curious to taste it and to really see, you know, what is the texture, where's the flavor, why is the color different? Do I like the bell pepper that's red better than the one that's yellow? And really seeing the process of growth and transition, and also understanding sort of how to take care of food, you know? How to, you know, you have seeds in a jar, and what do they need to survive, in a sense, to give you, to transform into that food, because they eventually like eat it. Like, food systems in general are such a big, are a part of any animal's lives, and we are animals as well. It has been one of the major challenges to feed humanity since, you know, we are alive as a species. So and food systems have just contributed a lot to environmental degradation.
So thanks for coming for this part of the class. You know, as you all know, we are talking in this class about ethnography and about the craft of writing about culture and societies. And in this particular part of the class, as you know, we are interested in how ethnographers in recent years have begun to use media to represent ethnographic information that goes beyond texts. Lissa is a book that was a sort of an experimental ethnography, a so-called graphic ethnofiction. It is based on field work, and it's based on real events and real people, but rather than representing the people that you've read here are fictional characters that are inspired by actual field work. What is it like to read this book?
I think it's really fascinating that you can see how the ethnographic description that you would usually read about in papers plays out in daily life. Mm-hmm. So in actual like conversations or settings or who are the people that you're talking to and so on. So it's really like zooming in onto the ground and seeing how do those like descriptions in ethnographic papers actually, where do they come from?
Auki and I are currently also taking a class on how to do ethnographic research and so on. And one of the first explanations of what that could mean or what that could entail is also like a deep hanging out. So you're just, it seems very easy, like you're hanging out with people, you're talking to them, you're having conversations, you're mm-hmm. just kind of also going with the flow, simply to give them also the agency to talk about whatever they want to talk about, what they find interesting, what they find important for us as researchers to know. But it seems easy to do, but still you need to somehow get the essence of what they're saying.
Het project Buurvrouw en Buurvrouw kon op
opkomst
wijze uit de zaal rekenen bij het opkomst, bij opkomst.
Yeah, I think it actually also fits Buurvrouw en Buurvrouw as an initiative, because also when you look at it, it seems quite easy to have like the bus with free food or the shop with free clothing and as a space to meet. But there are so many things that are coming into the idea of it, and how do you really put it into reality and so on.
Starts in my toes and I crinkle my nose. Wherever it goes, I always know that you make me smile. Please stay for a while.
Prezentacje projektów Living Lab to dla nas chyba najważniejsze akademickie wydarzenie roku. Wszyscy byli trochę nerwowi, ale i tak w dobrym humorze. W końcu zaraz po tym zaczynają się wakacje. Ach tak, rzeczywiście, trochę ścięłam włosy.
Welcome everyone. Welcome in this room, welcome in all the other rooms in the metaverse, and welcome online to our annual Living Lab conference.
If we shift the narrative not only from how can we have the most money, but actually how can we live happily for a very long time, then that will motivate people and it will bring different actors together. And our last finding is that there is a lack of coordination and communication, and that needs to change.
And the initiatives that we looked at by theory are good initiatives that want to help solve climate change, but by doing so they might be unintendedly reproducing structural injustices.
We found that there's overwhelmingly people with a nationality from the global north compared to Africa specifically in the boards, and also that the education is mainly centered in the global north, overwhelmingly.
So we suggest to these initiatives to involve more people from the global south in their decision making, as well as reflect on the possibility of them reproducing structural injustices in their work.
So what are the actual impacts of Buurvrouw en Buurvrouw on the community? Well, firstly, we found that by getting free food and clothing, people could benefit in a material and in a financial way. But what mostly stood out for us was the social impact that Buurvrouw en Buurvrouw had. And we found that within Buurvrouw en Buurvrouw, bonds and friendships were created, and Buurvrouw en Buurvrouw became a place for mutual care and having someone there who is willing to listen in difficult times.
Dear audience, it's a pleasure to tell you that this is the last presentation that you're going to listen to today, so a big applause for that. I'm Marianne, I'm working with Julia and Lotte, and to celebrate that we are the last presentation, we brought three jars of germinated lentils that we would like to pass around in the audience. The three jars have different stages of the germination process. I started at home, they're safe to eat.
Well, I still remember in class that you were performing as the president of Latvia. You made a very solid case for why we should support the country, so, well.
No, it's a joke, I'm not going to be the president of Latvia, but in general, yes.
Why not?
It's a difficult job.
Any job you're going to do is probably going to have some difficulties. Where do you see yourself in a few years?
Yeah, that's the big question. But ultimately, I do see myself contributing to my country, because that's the situation I know the best. Those are the people I know the best. And I don't know, there's very country-specific things that are really close to my heart also. So I, for example, now with the Ukraine, war in Ukraine, it's you can really see how it's dividing our society very clearly. And we're going to have elections by the end of August. So it's just, and people are in general not that happy. So if I could contribute to changing that, I would love that. That would be, I think that's where I'm supposed to be.
There is definitely a problem with Latvian parliament, because the average age of our parliament members is way higher than our average age of our population. And when you look at it a bit more closely, if they're older people, then they're the ones most likely to have been educated in the Soviet times. And like just a bunch of different, of course there is value in that perspective, but it just shouldn't be the whole majority of our parliament. I do think there should be some youth voices, because when you think about it, things that are decided now and affect the long term are going to affect the youth more. So I do think there should be higher representation of young people in our parliament for sure. It's also scary. I wouldn't in any way get in, I think, in the following years, because where would I start? So I have been thinking about it, and I do think there should be more youth representation, but probably that not by me, and maybe I enter politics a bit later in life.
I don't know. I think in this whole 2 years so far was like a huge it was like a huge journey, and I think, you know, I learned so much more than just like what's in the classroom. You know, I have so many more questions than answers, and sometimes it's so hard. I think I'm now a little bit more like social oriented. Okay. It's not that I'm not sustainability oriented, but it's more that I focus more maybe indeed on like human rights or something.
When we first met, you told me, well, I'm very into literature, maybe more than this, I don't know, I will find out.
I do miss literature, so that's something. I would miss other things if I did literature, and I miss literature now doing other things. But yeah, I think doing literature also wouldn't be the greatest thing. I would feel like I'm just reading books and not doing anything useful for anyone.
Like, where do you see yourself working in a few years?
Well, I haven't looked into master's programs yet, and right now I'm kind of developing also an interest for the media world. Mm-hmm. So kind of an intersection of, for example, gender matters or in general social justice issues.
Well, right now you're going to start an internship in Brussels. Very exciting. Is that also a field you want to develop further in?
Like 2 weeks ago, I had a meeting with a public strategist at the province, Friesland. And during that meeting, I realized I want to have his job.
I would love to become a strategist in the public sector. So that's someone who kind of really looks at where the organization of a government, be it local, municipal, national, whatever, kind of is going. So where they're heading, what should be their goals and things like that. And that's something I would really love to do, to see, because government has such a huge potential in doing things, and sometimes I feel like they're wasting that a little bit. And I would love to contributing for governments and the public sector to really find that and to be able to make a change, because they have the means, they have the money, they have the infrastructure, they have the reach, and I just want to help really facilitate change with this instrument. And that's something that's what I want to do later on in my life, yeah.
There seems to be no fork in your house anymore.
It's in the dishwasher, it's clean.
Oh, okay, thank you. I forgot you had a dishwasher.
Well, thank you very much all for being here. We really enjoy you guys being here. We hope you all have fun and have this nice gala end of moving year with Corona, deadlines, stress, everything, and everything not. So we really hope you have a nice ending of the evening, especially for the third years. This is probably one of your last evenings here. Enjoy. And for the second years, of course, we're going on exchange.
I'm gonna fight them all. A certain nation army couldn't hold me back.
And the stains coming from my blood.
I'm not comprehending yet. I'm not really understanding that I'm leaving. It's just, I'm doing something and probably it will kick in 3 days. Or sometimes it kicks on the plane where I'm like,
I'm actually going physically away. But now I'm trying, I guess I'm also trying to not think about it a lot because it has been just really nice. It's been so, so nice. I'm so happy here.
Só a autocarro?
Yeah.
Mas só a partir de uma certa data?
Aqui está a mandar os combustíveis disponíveis.
How do I feel about leaving? I'm excited. I have been ready to finish this academic year for a while, so leaving is the hallmark of summer starts for me, and I need it. I need it.
Of course, I'm sad because I'm not going to come back to my peers, because I'm going to stay in Brussels for a whole year. And that's kind of sad, so like when I come back, they already have graduated, the people I spent 2 years with. But I am really excited to go to Brussels.
Do it. Like, on the one hand, I'm of course a little sad to be moving, but at the same time, like, I know I'm coming back.
But I'm also excited to go to Lapland. I know that that's where my home is, so whenever also... Yeah, so it's just the feeling there, it's everything I know, and also the nature, but of course also people, my family, I haven't seen them, my brothers, they're probably taller than me now. It's offensive because they're 3 and 6 years younger.
I'm very, not hopeful, but like, I think it's gonna be good. Yeah.
Wszyscy wyjeżdżają gdzieś na lato. Dobrze być na parę tygodni w Krakowie. Chociaż myślami już jestem w Genewie, gdzie będę robić semestr wymiany z nauk politycznych. Wisława Szymborska i ja pochodzimy z tego samego miasta, z Krakowa. Jak wiesz, dostała Nagrodę Nobla z Literatury za swoje wiersze. No i wygłosiła w Oslo świetny wykład noblowski. Każdym utworem próbuje na to odpowiedzieć, ale kiedy tylko postawi kropkę, już ogarnia go wahanie. Już zaczyna sobie zdawać sprawę, że jest to odpowiedź tymczasowa i absolutnie niewystarczająca. Więc próbuje jeszcze raz i jeszcze raz, a potem te kolejne dowody jego niezadowolenia z siebie historycy literatury zepną wielkim spinaczem i nazywać będą dorobkiem. Marzą mi się czasem sytuacje niemożliwe do urzeczywistnienia. No i w końcu to właściwie za sprawą jej wierszy mogliśmy wam w ogóle opowiedzieć tę historię.
Lina, Linnea, Marianna,
and
Susanna.
Yes. We're gonna have a Q&A sessions. Q&A session with Lina, Lea, Susanna, the three L's, and Susanna.
And
Annette, Marianne. Of course. Marianna is not there, right? Or is she?
No, she's not online.
We're gonna switch to the hybrid setting, and then we have a Q&A. Lea, Lina, Linnea, and Susanna, can you please turn on your camera?
Shall I stand there and you will hear and I there?
Yeah, I will walk in the room and
Hey! I think her brothers grew there.
Do we have questions for Lina or for other students or for Annet? Lina, how are you doing abroad?
I can say something if you want. As you can see, I have young friends.
Leia in Finland.
Leia in Finland, please. How are you doing abroad?
I have fine friends and we've gone on amazing trips and uni is still stressful, but it's also nice. And I'm really having a good time.
Thank you. Do we have others? Do you have specific people you would like to know how they're doing?
Linnea and Lina, are you guys still debating?
Well, I don't know what I would debate about. I live in a house with a lot of other girls who are Italian, and whenever I cook pasta in the kitchen, because we have a shared kitchen, I feel like I'm doing it wrong, and I don't know if I want to debate about it, because they're probably right, so it's a bit of a stressful time for me.
Actually, at my I'm working at a consultancy now, and I introduced the bathroom polls we had at uni, and I asked the question, about freedom of speech in a democracy. And apparently it fostered debate in the office and one of the senior people didn't like it. And he was like, we can't have this. I don't want just so political division. And I thought it was funny. It was like the whole point. And he didn't like that. So I guess I didn't debate with him directly, but people in the office, well, I made them debate apparently. So I guess the answer is
yes. Yes.
Is it difficult coming from the bubble from Leeuwarden to go into a new world and kind of bring that mindset into a new, well, world in a sense?
Linnea, that was a question to you, I think, because you're on screen.
Okay. Well, for me, it's a huge shift. I still, like, my colleagues are all very progressive and liberal. Most of them, I think, but we work for companies who really aren't. So this is a really interesting thing. For example, yeah, I work for people from the chemical sector, and for example, pollution is a huge issue. And yeah, we try to promote that cause because it's our job. It's also part of democratic dialogue. Bubble right now. Companies who pour millions into lobbying for something that maybe is not so great. So, yeah, it's really difficult, but also really fun to see these perspectives.
Thank you. There's a question coming from Andre.
Well, first of all, I would like to really congratulate you. You were really the stars. And I want to say specifically, Susanna, I'm so proud of you that You just triggered something that you probably didn't know what you would trigger in this very moment. And I'm wondering, Susanna, tell us, what new things are you triggering now? What are you up to?
Hi, thank you very much. And thank you, Annet, for the film. It was really lovely to see how we can be seen from outside. I'm currently in Geneva. I'm doing a minor here. And I'm just starting to settle in, so nothing big coming up as yet, I think. You need to wait for the right moment.
Indira.
Yes, thanks. Annet, maybe for you, do you think you succeeded in with the documentary in explaining what this DRL thing is? Do you think, because for us it's so obvious, and also for them being in the bubble, as we said, it's probably quite obvious, but do you think for the outside world, that it's understandable based on your document? Like, do you think that was, I think, one of your aims, right?
Of course, I would like to show a broader audience what was going on here, what the studies is about, and what the topics are, and how young people grow into these topics. But it sometimes it was like difficult, right? Because there is a lot of content. Like there is studies. It was Elise Rumeyers with her political philosophy, and I remember my editors. I remember my editor later said, "Is this not too complicated for the people? You know, would people trying to understand this?" And so, and then you have to ask yourself, should I explain it a bit more or not? And we agreed on, well, let people crack their brain a little bit, right? Like students have to do. And it's okay to challenge your audience a bit, and you don't have to explain everything. And for me, as a filmmaker, it is, if your heart goes with these wonderful women, and you follow them, how they addressing everything, then you're in a good track, and you don't have to understand everything, but you go with them in it. And yes, I had to trust that, you know, because I cannot explain everything, and it would be way too boring, right? You have to go with them, and especially this part, that is, yeah, there's a lot of really, there is this living lab topics going on. So this is a little bit more technical. Like one is much more about personality and emotions, and part two is really into politics and Ukraine, you know, and East and West and Europe. So, but yes, they succeeded to tell the story, and I succeeded, I think, to put them on the platform. And I'm really convinced that it is an interesting story for people, really, because everybody has to address these issues about the future and how, what's my role in it, being young or being old. We at the moment, we make many films at FryslânDOK about these topics, but they are different. Anytime it's different because farmers address it differently, and older people do it differently, and young people, you are in a really special position. And this, especially, this is the stories that we have to tell, right? From that, I'm really convinced about that. Yeah.
Susanna, I was wondering, did you find a way to include literature or writing in your life a little bit more?
Well, I'm actually doing a course in literature right now, so a little bit, yes. And I'm thinking of doing something connected to writing and journalism in the future. So that would be kind of
nice.
Yeah. Hi. Sorry. It's great to see you guys all again, first of all. I was wondering, during any point of filming this project, was there a moment where you guys were like, what have we gotten ourselves into? Or perhaps a moment of, I don't want to film right now. Can you please enlighten me more on that?
Lina, can you go first?
Yes, I have a lot to say about this. So at the very, very beginning, okay, and when I came to Western Europe, one of the things I realized is that people tend to talk a lot and they have a lot of great ideas, but it doesn't often translate into words. So when we had our like first chats about the possibility of maybe sometimes having a movie, I was like, ha, yes, of course, it sounds like a good idea. But Annette is a woman that actually does what she says. So that was my first mistake, and it actually turned into a project. And of course, I was very scared of putting your kind of personality and thoughts and emotions and feelings at this moment in life kind of on screen, because the movie will never change, you know, it's kind of always there. So if I change my opinion completely, it's still there. So it's, of course, sometimes it was like, do I want to do this? But at the end, like it, you kind of, at least for me, I realized it's not about me as much as it's about the whole general concept also and showing that to the world. So it kind of, the aim was more valuable than my personal kind of, I don't really want to do this. So I think at the end of the day, it was really good. And thank you for everyone who was invested into the project.
Thank you so much to participate in this documentary. Linnea, would you like to react to this question as well? Do you have moments where you thought maybe this was not the best idea? Linnea, sorry.
Okay, sorry. I wasn't sure if you said Lea or my name. Yes, I did. In the beginning, well, sort of in the beginning of the year. It was winter. I had a breakup. I wasn't in the best place, and it's not really something you want to see on camera, maybe. So, yeah, I definitely had these moments where I was like, yeah, no, maybe not today. But Annette did an amazing job in still, of course, respecting that and always making us feel comfortable. And at this point also, because somehow I haven't gotten the chance, I feel like, to say thank you, Annette, for making this, because even though sometimes it might have been weird, also like the camera is huge and also the microphone, sometimes really, really odd if you're also giving a presentation or something. But this is also like a really nice thing, I think, for our community to have this. And also, of course, for myself and for my friends to kind of look back at this in the future and be like, this was me when I was 23. And I was like, you know, so yeah, it's awesome. It was really amazing and incredible. And also seeing the finished product, it's really, really nice. So thank you for everyone, and especially you, Annette.
Thank you, Linnea. So nice to say that. But that is right. There was a period you were not feeling well. And you know, you cannot put a camera in someone's face who is not feeling well. I cannot do it. I mean, you must have a really good reason to do that. And I couldn't think of a reason. If you're not feeling well, I think, well, it will change and she will feel better. And then, and that was what happened. Then you were so eloquent about it, explaining and saying I was not feeling well. And I already thanked you for expressing, saying that you found out that you're really smart. And I already thank you on behalf of all the women to say that. Really, it was so good that you said that. And yes, smartness also comes with sometimes you feel really bad, and you find your way to have both things in the open. And I think that is such an example for everyone, right? To be vulnerable and to say things.
Thank you so much. I actually, this is something that JL actually taught me. So thanks to everyone in the community that it's okay to be vulnerable, because if you, like, this is something that I feel like our teachers and our peers teach us, that it's about if you have a problem, someone else has it too. So, or a question, especially if you have a question, someone else probably has it too. So you might as well ask it. And maybe someone else also benefits from you asking it, or it starts a dialogue or even a social movement or whatever. So I think this is really one of the central points of GRL. So this is something that you can't teach in a book or something. It happens with the community where people trust each other. So yeah, thanks to everyone. It's like a really amazing experience to be in this community.
We have another question.
Yes, first of all, Susanna, we're missing you in the mind-sharing committee. And then I also have a question. What is your favorite part of the documentary? Because we talked about like the bad parts or the parts that you weren't really standing behind your decision, or like were maybe like doubting about it. But yeah, what was your favorite part?
Oh, that's a difficult question. By the way, both Lina, Linnea, and Lea also formed the mind sharing committee just a little earlier on, so we have quite some team here. I really like to just see the girls, especially talking about the future, but also just noticing the little moments where their character stands out a lot. Being a bit grounded into the earth, thinking more concretely, or being very humorous as well, in a very specific way. It's just really fun to watch.
I have a question for Susanna. Maybe I have not asked you. Was it not really, really funny to reenact something what had happened, because the letter had already happened, and we ask you to be an actor, like to reenact your own life? How weird was that, really?
I think it was funnier answering your questions at some point during the bigger interview. That's a little bit of it I've actually got in another episode. So it's always a challenge to answer Annette's questions and not answer Annette's questions and find the right balance of both. So reenacting something what you did, feeling awkward about it, is easier compared to that.
I love talking to Susanna. You know, one of the first things she said, this Wisława Szymborska, she's not so, many people in Polish don't think that she is such a great, so great a poet. There's a lot of critic about her, you know? She said, that was so nice, because I thought, oh, I have this Nobel Prize winner on my door, you know? But it's, Susanna, it's nice.
We have Maybe it's worth adding. The poem that you have on the door, it's really uninviting. Just check out the poem. It's very funny that you have it on the door.
Because?
Well, the poem is about not letting somebody in. That's even more of a miracle that happened.
Yes, it is strange. I agree.
Hi. My question is, so is there any segment or scene that in the end didn't make it into the documentary, but that you guys still think is of value or some special meaning? And a quick statement is that, Lena, you should reconsider the Latvian presidency candidacy, because Eastern Europe needs more people like you.
Amen. Lea, can you answer that question? Is there a part that not end up in the final cut, but was still interesting and something you can share about?
Yeah, I think there was probably even more material that didn't make it compared to the material that did make it. I don't have one specific thing in mind, I think, but one thing that really did stuck with me was our COVID month. I think I am pretty sure it did make the documentary at some point, but it was very brief. But for a bit more context, it was like just the beginning when we were filming the documentary, and somehow we all caught COVID, and we just got it, like the first person got it, and then the week after the second person got it. So we were all quarantining for about a month. And I wouldn't say that was the most fun time, obviously. It was very much a roller coaster of emotions, really. But I think it does really highlight also what was going on in that time, and also how we as a community, or specifically as a household, also try to manage the situation. And I believe it really caught the core of the GRL community, like being there for each other, just trying to give everyone a hand that needs it. And really trying to see the brighter side of it as well. So I would have liked to see a bit more of that as well, but at the same time, I know I wasn't really feeling myself on those days either. So it kind of goes back to what Linnea was saying, like, of course, on the days where it's more challenging to film, you don't end up filming as much and you don't really want to put yourself out there so much. But I think it does capture the spirit quite nicely. So I would love to hear from the community when they do see also that episode and that particular scene, how they feel about it.
And it's in the documentary, right, Annette?
Yes, it is. Parts, yeah. Of course it is in part one. Everybody's sitting, everybody having COVID, only having singing a bird outside, and it was the only thing. But it was a thing we also were discussing. Shall we have it in it, and how long should it be? And Indira had a really good remark on that when we were viewing. Because in the beginning, it was like more in the beginning of part one. And you said, maybe do it a bit later. And it was such a good idea. And I did that. Thank you. I put it later because the effect is so much better. That first they do all sort of smart thing, nice thing, and suddenly, bam, quarantine, and they stay home. So that was. So, you can go editing a film.
I think we're running out of time. I want a final applause for the stars of the show. Thank you for participating in this film. Thank you for joining this evening in this hybrid setting. It was really great to see you, and we hope to see you again in February, Susanna, Linnea, Lina, and Leia. Then we go to the final slide with the dates and times that the full documentary is in three parts will be shown to the Netherlands. It will be broadcasted on the local broadcaster Omrop Fryslân, but also on NPO2, the national broadcast.
And it will be online, of course, and you will share the links.
Via the socials, we will share the right links. So every Saturday, and for the coming 3 weeks, you will be watching the beautiful documentary. And of course, you're going to see the last part, part three, again, because it's also fun to watch a second time. I would like to thank you all for visiting the Beurs, be here, and hope to see you again.
Yeah. And I think the Leo de Courant will write about it. Yes, they got a link. He had watched it, all the three parts, Martin Penewaert. And I expect him to write about it. So I hope for that. Yeah. Yes, the Leo de Courant is in it. So I said to him. Oh, it's a bit of it.
Not just because I want to have the last word, but because I also really want to thank Angeline and Roland News, who kind of made this happen, because I remember when you started this idea, I was like, oh my God, our students are so vocal. What are they going to say? Should we be doing this? But I think, yeah, like Annette said, you also said, like, but we also trust our community and it will be fine. So let's do it. And Roland News, the Living Labs, this is your thing. And it's amazing. I think it really showcases what we do with the Living Labs, how local it is, how we try to make an impact. So also big applause to Roland News. And with that, I would say there's still cake outside and it's for charity. So please go ahead. Thank you.
Yeah, that's good.